各位观众朋友大家好，欢迎收看这一节的民进连线，我是维仁，在纽约为您带来重要新闻。反送中运动在世界各地上演，也吸引了许多西方媒体记者的报道。其中一名澳洲的记者在街头的访问这几天实在是非常的火。这名澳洲记者呢，他走上当地的街头，问这些反对支持反送中抗议队伍的海外中国人，你们的立场是什么呢？什么是五大诉求呢？结果似乎没有一个他访问的在场的海外中国人能够顺利的说出这五大诉求。他们似乎连这个香港的民众在争取什么都不知道，就走上街头去示威。而他们都认为呢，五大诉求里面，这个没有一个是港独哦。不过他们似乎认为，这个香港民众他们主要的诉求好像是港独吧，所以呢就走上街头了。所以我们就先来看一看这一段，现在在网络上非常火红的这段影片。
Hong Kong is part of China forever, from a history and from a fact.
They've got five demands. Are you against their demands?
Of course.
Which demand?
What is the five demands?
Withdraw the extradition order.
But they've done it now.
You tell me what's the five demands, actually.
Listen. I don't give a fuck about his question. Only one China, okay?
好，所以我们可以看到呢，这个访问其实让很多在看的民众会觉得，有点不忍看下去哦，因为似乎在街头的这些中国的学生，他们似乎对于这五大诉求不是非常的了解。所以，我们今天呢，也很荣幸可以邀请到人在澳洲的这名我们刚看到的记者，Avi 来到我们的现场。Hi, Avi. Am I pronouncing your name right?
That's right. Yep.
So we know it's very early in Australia. Thank you so much for waking up early and join us on the show. So let's dive right into the viral videos, the ones that we just watched. The content, obviously, it's very viral worthy because obviously a lot of these protesters or anti-protesters who are on the street, they couldn't really answer your questions. So can you please walk us through?What was it like? Did you ask a very simple questions, and was it pretty obvious they just did not know the answer?
Yeah, it became obvious to me as I was walking around and speaking to mainlanders, which you can kind of pick on the edges of these protests as people who didn't seem too happy with the Hong Kong rally. And I just approached them and I could see straight away that they didn't actually knowthe reason why those protesters were out. They didn't know the five demands. For them, they just kept repeating it's about independence, it goes against the one country, two systems. And when I pushed them to explain to me how and which one of the five demands, none of them could answer it.
Right, so do you feel like these Chinese protesters, obviously they put an effort to be on the street. Do you feel like they understand like a slight bit of what these Hong Kong protesters are protesting?
I think what's happened is that they've just seen in these social media groups that there's a Hong Kong rally, and they wanted to come out and either just observe it or two weeks before I filmed those two videos, there were clashes in that exact same spot on the street at another Hong Kong rally where university student groups came out.To attack the Hong Kong students and the pro-Hong Kong group. So there's obviously a social media thing where they're letting each other know that it's happening there and they kind of come out to counter it. But I still don't think, if you look at the second video where it was, I was standing on the street, I was actually reporting on an absolutely different protest andA mainland Chinese student walks up to me and he says, oh, you're the guy that does the videos. I saw a video you did on Hong Kong. Now, the video itself, which you just played a clip of, showed where I'd exposed the Chinese mainlanders for not knowing the five demands. And he knew that. He watched the video. But then when I put the same question to him, he also didn't know it. So it's almost like they feel like they don't need to know it because...They know the truth, and the truth is that these the Hong Kong protests are just about independence, and that's the bottom line. It's like they're regurgitating the CCP narrative, and they're not interested, and they don't believe anything else.
Right. So that was also a very interesting video, the one you just mentioned. Because as you mentioned, the guy, he noticed you and he noticed the work you've done before. And obviously he has something to say. But when you turned the table back to him, obviously he wasn't ready to answer those questions. But as a reporter, I wonder, because sometimes we would edit a video in a way that's more appealing to the audience. So amongst all the people you interview on the street, was it like 100%? You're pretty sure they just don't really know what's going on?
All the people I put on in the first video was everyone I spoke to, was everyone I could find that were, and I was looking for them. None of them knew the five demands. There was a couple of them that knew the extradition bill as a concept, but when you delve deeper into it, they didn't even really get the extradition bill. To them, the extradition bill meant withdrawing it means that you're going against the one country, two systems. It means that you want independence. I don't know how they make these massive leaps. The only way that I can kind of understand it is that they're watching state TVs, the state propaganda, and they're just being fed one narrative which tells them that if you support the Hong Kong protests in any which way, any of the demand, then you're supporting independence.
Right. So as a English language news outlet, Western media, quote unquote, how do you feel? Because me as a Chinese language media outlet, obviously we feel like we probably have a more comprehensive view of what's going on and how it's going to unfold and why people have different points of view. So for the mainstream media in Australia, how are they watching this event unfold? What's their point of view? Do you think they fully understand what's going on? Or give us your observation.
I think it's interesting. I think the Hong Kong protests have kind of, it's the one time that a lot of the media agree. And a lot of the media see it for what it is. I'm not part of the mainstream media, but a lot of the mainstream media have given it fair coverage here as well. I think when you go there, and as a journalist, when I was there, when you experience a lot of protests, and you've gone and reported on a lot of protests, you see something different in Hong Kong. I went to a protest where there was almost 2 million people, not one police officer. And it was the calmest, nicest protest I've ever attended in my career. In fact, I had to get to the other side of the protest against the crowd. And I was running with my cameraman through the crowd, and people were just parting ways and apologizing to me. You go to a protest here in the West with 100 people, you won't be able to get through the crowd. You go in England, in New York, I've been to protest. It's just not a thing that doesn't happen. Which just kind of shows the grassroots support and the kind of people supporting the movement. It's not what it's being portrayed as by the CCP. It's not the black shirts who come out at night and fight the police. It's actually one in four Hong Kongers hit the streets. That is a phenomenal number. And the majority of them, the vast majority of them, are very peaceful. The Chinese government pushed to their to the Chinese people that it's this minority of violent black shirts is what they were calling them, who are just trying to fight for independence. When the truth is, when you go there, it's most Hong Kongers who are proud to be Chinese by culture, and that's what's important, and that's what's important for Chinese people and mainlanders to recognize is that the majority, there is a small minority that talk about independence, very small. The majority of Hong Kongers are proud Chinese by culture, by language, by food, by everything, besides the fact that they don't want anything to do with the CCP. They don't like the communist government, but they love the Chinese people and culture, and that's the way they see themselves, and they want to protect that. They just want their democracy and their freedom. And basically what they're fighting for in those five reasonable demands. And what I find hard is when you talk to mainlanders, you just can't get that point across. They won't listen.
Right. I think I've talked to a lot of my other interviewees on the program. I think what the point of view of some of these Chinese immigrants and students are very much ingrained in their minds since they were, you know, going through kindergarten, elementary school. It's just this concept that they have a really hard time to get around with. So I actually answered some of the questions that I proposed earlier. I was going to ask you, what was your first-hand experience in Hong Kong? Because as a reporter, I do envy you to be able to go there and get some first-hand footage and be able to experience what the protest is like. Because me, being in New York, I get very mixed messages. On Twitter, from both sides, the pro-China side, you see a lot of very violent protesters, and the pro-Hong Kong democracy side, you also see a lot of police brutality. And also a lot of independent journalists and reporters are there, and they do have a lot of really violent footages. But you're saying that when you were there, everything's kind of peaceful.
Listen, I went to both. There's kind of two protest movements happening at the same time. There's the large, the huge, the biggest I've ever seen protests where they come out to the park, Victoria Park, and it's planned whether they get permission or they don't get permission, which is important to know because when I was there, they didn't get the permission wasn't granted, but they still came out, and there was almost 2 million on the street that day. And it was peaceful. I've never seen anything as peaceful as that in my life. And not one police officer. But then you come out at night and it's the younger groups where you do see the clashes with police. I'm not going to say that none of those young protesters are violent. When I say violent, I've seen them throwing eggs. They're stopping traffic. In fact, I aired some of that. But when you see the brutality from the police, it's not... It's just not necessary. And the thing that I noticed is that when there were no police, there was no violence in any of the protests, whether it's the large one in the day with the majority of the country supporting, or even when it's the smaller breakout group all across Hong Kong. It kind of fires up at any moment from Thursday night to Sunday morning. But at both these protests, when there are no police, there are no violence. Now, I did also speak to a number of police officers who were explaining to me that they don't care about the politics. For them, it's about law and order, which I find it hard to believe. I find it really hard to believe because I witnessed myself where even police turning on press and in a very, very violent and aggressive way. So I do, when I look at it as an outsider, I do feel that at least command are being ruled by the Chinese mainland. They're being pushed or within the government to shut down these protests, which have failed miserably.
Right. And lastly, I know you've already kind of answered this already too, but as an independent Western journalist, why do you think so many Chinese students who are overseas, outside of China, they just cannot understand the Hong Kong protest?
I think that they just fit that narrative and they just parrot it. And it's unfortunate because they're quite clever people. You talk to them and they're not stupid. You know, I'm used to going to protests where either the people protesting or the counter-protesters, like these mainland Chinese people in this case, are usually very simple and they have no idea about anything. But these mainlanders are intelligent people, but this is the effect of being brainwashed from childhood, and they can't see the other side, and they can't see when you put to them that there are five demands and the five demands are very clear and very reasonable. Which one of these demands are you against? And which one of these demands are calling for independence? You can't say that the protesters are demanding independence when they're not. And they will explain to you that, oh, no, this is just a soft approach. They're going for these first and then they're going for independence. Well, how do you make that leap, especially when you don't talk to Hong Kongers? Especially when you're not willing to engage the other side, especially when you're talking to a an independent journalist from the outside who's telling you from a, speaking to you from a neutral position, trying to understand your perspective. And even then you can't really make the proper connection, join the dots here where they're asking for independence. So it, for me, in short, it's about being brainwashed and fed that propaganda from when they're a child. And it's really well done, because when they talk to you, they will turn it back on you. As a Western journalist, they'll say, stop watching the propaganda, CNN, Fox News, the Western media. You're just being fed them. And it's ludicrous, the idea that our press here, who Fox News and CNN, who do not are ideologically opposed on so many issues. On this, they seem to be united, because it's about free press. And the fact is, we do have free press by large here in the West. We have independent journalists, and everybody kind of agrees. Everybody's on the same position here, because we're just reporting the fact. And you're the only ones who are actually watching one source, which is state run. And you think we're the biased ones, and you're so convinced that the rest of the world is biased. And I don't know how to beat that.
Right. So do you feel oftentimes when you engage in these conversations, you're kind of just in a loop that you just cannot
get? You go in a loop. It's a loop. And I guess that's why for me it was important just to create these videos, because I wasn't going to change their mind. There was no way. I'm good. I'm not that good. There was no way for me to change their minds. What I wanted to do, and I can see it's been successful, is to show the rest of the world. And hopefully when other mainlanders kind of see it in the way that I've presented it, you see it going round in circles, and that maybe people just need to wake up and mainlanders need to look at it and go, okay, let's just look at the five demands. Let's look at it and judge them based on their own merit. So we'll see. Only time will tell.
Right. So do you have any future plans to go back onto the streets and ask more questions other than the five demands?
We'll see. You know how this industry works. It works. It moves quickly. So as things change, I would love to get back to Hong Kong. It was actually my first time in Hong Kong, and I loved it. So I'm looking for an excuse to go back to Hong Kong, but I'm hoping in better circumstances.
Right. And I think there's probably a highly chance that you would have more chances to go back to Hong Kong. But as you said, hopefully it's for a better cause. And thank you so much for waking up early and sharing your thoughts with us today. Thank you.
Thanks for having me.
所以以上就是今天的民进连线。刚刚跟我们连线的呢，就是人在澳洲的记者 Avi Tamili。他对于这个在街头呢跟中国学生的互动以及他们之间的交流呢，给我们非常非常第一手的深刻的这个解读。所以如果呢您有任何的对这个节目的想法呢，也欢迎您在下方给我们留言，也请您点赞转发今天的节目，并请在 YouTube 订阅民进电视。我是维仁，我们下次再见。打开民进电视，每次都是新世界。节目中言论为个人见解，不代表民进的观点或立场。 YouTube 频道名民进火拍，苹果博客名民进火拍音频版，网站 www.minjingnews.com， 推特 @minjingnews。